My name is Søren Østergaard. I'm from Aarhus University, and I'm very happy to be here. We have been working on this research for a long time, so it's nice to be able to be here to tell you about it. And you seem to be quite awake and interested in discussing things, so I think it'll be interesting, hopefully. And what I'll talk about is HACCP and animal management and economics. In this GplusE project, there are work packages, as you have heard about, and I'm involved in one of the late work packages, work package 6, where we are supposed to turn these research results, as you have heard on before, into some management on farm. So therefore, HACCP, we have used the HACCP concept to introduce these results into some management. And we will also we have also done some economic analysis on the effect of this. And we have been a lot of many people working on this. And some of those are mentioned here. Those are who have helped me to prepare this presentation. Other people from Aarhus University, but we have also worked together with other people from the EU project doing the way. I have something on HACCP, something on economy. How many of you have been working with HACCP before? Is that something that is familiar to you, the HACCP concept? More or less, a little bit? Yeah, and economics, all of you, for sure. Everybody knows about economics. Maybe this is slightly different, but just ask. And I have a presentation, present you the results, and I have planned a little exercise. But maybe I will do it up here, and then I will give you the tool, because it's the tool where you can do some economic analysis, and you can have it to play with at home. Okay, do not hesitate to interrupt and ask questions if there is something that is not clear. Okay? The outline of the teaching is that first I will tell you about the HACCP concept, the very general thing, what is HACCP about? And then I'll tell you about a study we have done to develop a HACCP concept for critical negative energy balance. Then we did an evaluation of this HACCP concept using the FT-MIR analysis, which we have just heard about, put it into a HACCP concept and try it out in two real herds. And then the final two topics is economics of this about imbalanced cows, how to calculate the economics of that, how to calculate the economics of having a system to avoid it. And the last thing is some economics of one of the corrective actions coming from the HACCP concept. So that's the plan. Introduction to HACCP. The HACCP concept, the HACCP is abbreviation for HACCP analysis critical control point. It's known from the food industry, and it's actually something that companies who is producing food, they are quite often, it's by law, they should have a HACCP plan for controlling the food safety. And it's all about that you should not only focus on when something has went wrong. You should find out how are the production process. You should identify and evaluate some critical points in your production, some risk, and make a plan of how to deal with that. So it's about to be proactive rather than being reactive, finding risk factors and operate on how to avoid those risk factors during the production process rather than just realize when something went wrong. So from food industry, they're very familiar with HACCP. And actually, if you ask around in companies, many companies have some kind of HACCP concept embedded in their quality control system. Something that is very general about HACCP is the seven HACCP principles. Is how to develop the HACCP plan for a production process in your company. So you need to conduct a HACCP analysis. What are the risks? What are the hazards in your production? Identify critical control points. establish critical limits for each critical control point, and you should establish a monitoring system. You should establish a list of corrective actions if something go wrong, and they do sometimes. And then you should have some procedures to ensure that the system is up working all the time. And finally, you should have some kind of a record keeping procedure to keep record on what is done in your company. That's the seven HACCP principles you should go through to develop the HACCP if you want to introduce it in your company or in the production process. So what do have that have to do with all this about imbalanced and so on and the GplusE? It is that we have developed a HACCP concept, try to do it, on critical negative energy balance. And during this stage, you've probably heard a lot of different terms of this about balanced, imbalanced, imbalanced metabolic status. And here I use the term critical negative energy balance. And that has to do with we have been working on this over the years. And in the beginning, the very first result of this project was saying that maybe the best phenotype we will come up with something related to critical negative energy balance. And this is more or less the same as physiological imbalance. So, but in the beginning, we used this term critical negative energy balance. And this one describes what it's about, and you've probably seen this one before. We think of this as you have a cow which is normal producing, normal health, normal production in the beginning. Then it may start to being at a state of physiological imbalance, which is suboptimal production, suboptimal health, but it's still not a diseased animal. It's not even subclinical diseased, so it is at a state before that. The next state is subclinical diseased, and finally, she will be clinical ill and have a severe reduced production. So the idea is to detect the cow in physiological imbalance and do something and move her back to a normal state. So there is a link to the HACCP, because that's also what HACCP is about. It is to catch something that is starting to going wrong in the production process and correct it before it turns into something that is severe. Skip this one. The way we developed this HACCP concept for physiological imbalance or critical negative energy balance is that we generated an expert panel. That's if you look in a textbook about HACCP, this is one way of doing it. And we had a PhD study on this, and she asked the researchers and advisors from EU countries, and the selection criteria were that they should have at least 5 years of senior experience in animal science. Our advisory other inclusion criteria was that we would only have two experts per research institution, and the experts should also be anonymous for each other. In total, we generated a panel of 30 experts from Europe, 18 researchers and 12 advisors. The idea was that they should help us to generate this this HACCP system based on their background knowledge on negative energy balance. Because that was also an issue, maybe this about balanced and imbalanced, the way that Emil told you, and physiological imbalance is it's somehow new, whereas negative energy balance is something that is quite well known by many people. So we can go out and ask people about this concept and they will know what we are talking about. Okay, how is that? How is the study done? The study is done by having sent out three questionnaires to these experts. First, we give them the definition of negative energy balance, and we ask these people, these experts, to list possible risk factors for negative energy balance. So they returned a lot of answers to us with risk factors. Then we analyzed this, and in the second questionnaire, we gave them a list of the selected risk factors from the first one. And then they were asked to score each of them on severity and frequency, because we need to have to, that's a part of this this system, this Delphi system of doing this, that you need to try to find some kind of consensus among the experts. So they should, for each of the factors, they should score severity and frequency. Based on that, they had we analyzed again, and they had the final and the third and the final questionnaire. And they here gave the list of the most important risk factors from the previous one. And based on that, they were asked to give critical control points, how to monitor this situation, and what could be control values, and what could be corrective actions. All of this they were asked to answer in this third questionnaire for each of the risk factors. So you can imagine these researchers have a lot of ideas, and they surely did. Actually, they provided us with 150 suggestions for risk factors. So of course we had to reduce and go for consensus. That's also a part of the concept. And what you see here is the 11 most severe risk factors based on the experts. So what you see out left is the risk factors, and then is the average score on severity and frequency. So insufficient feed level, poor claw health, high rate of body condition, score loss, fat liver syndrome, professionalism of farmer and staff, restricted feeding, difficult access to feed bunk, insufficient water availability, varying feed quality, genetic merit for mobilization, and high milk yield. That were the risk factors they thought were most severe regarding critical negative energy balance. And what you see out to the right is that when we looked at the critical control point that they provided us, then you can see how many critical control point they provided us for each of the risk factors. So some of them had many critical control points, whereas others had quite few. You could also look at it the other way around. If we look at all the critical control points, that is the issues that is supposed to be looked at in a farm to avoid this. If we look at all the suggestions, how many, if we look at each of them, how many risk factors do each of them relate to? And examples of critical control points across all the risk factors are those that you see here. Cow feed space ratio, so the stocking density you could say, and a number of critical control point about body condition scoring. Not surprisingly, negative energy balance and body condition scoring is has usually been connected. So they have a number of critical control point related to that. General ad libitum feeding, and generally energy level, starch content of a feed. So you can see this is a frequency on how many frequencies they each of them relate to. Let's take the first of them, the cow feed space ratio, and put it into the perspective with all the other aspects. Again, the HACCP is the critical negative energy balance. We only have here the cow feed space ratio as a critical control point. And as you saw before, it relates to five different risk factors. You can see them up there. And the critical value, as they suggested, was that the cow should have at least 0.8 meter of feed bunk space per cow, or maximum 1.1 cow per feed bunk space. And how often should you look at this? that should be something you should look at ongoing, day to day, when moving cows to other sections, and you should have a prognosis and plan for next 3 months stocking at least. And what should you do if it's not fulfilled? You should reduce the number of cows in the pen, or increase thraw, or provide individual feeding, plan for suitable stocking rate increase and decrease, and ensure sufficient buffer capacity. So that is something that come out of this, a catalog of risk factors, critical control point, critical values, and corrective actions. And we are still in the process of completing this, but that's soon to be ready to be published. Yeah, conclusion from this, this questionnaire survey based on this Delphi approach that provide us with many risk factors and critical control points, and therefore reduction or consensus, the consensus task is important to develop a generic HACCP system. And also, it's clear from this study that to make this practical applicable in herd, you need to have a HACCP team to use this catalog based on this study and then reduce it to what is relevant in your herd, because many of these tasks are not relevant in all herds. But it's a starting point. You can say pick from this one and find out which one of those risk factors are important in this herd and which critical control points should you select. Yes, that was the study about developing HACCP for critical negative end balance. And now I'll switch to this study in the two Danish herds. Are there any questions for this about the HACCP study? No? Yeah?
One of the conclusions was to reduce the feeding space, right? To reduce the number of animals per pen.
Yeah.
But that is a suggestion for farmers or?
Yeah. The idea is that you are in a herd, you are concerned about imbalanced cows, cows in critical negative imbalance. You set up some risk factors and difficult access to feed bunk. You think in this herd, that might be an issue. And the cow feed space ratio, that's something you should observe then. You should continuously observe what is the cow feed space ratio in this herd. And if you register that this ratio become that you have more than 1.1 cow per feed bunk space, then you should be aware. Then you should have, if you have a HACCP plan, then you have something saying, what should I do then? Then you should have an action plan. Maybe you should use your buffer capacity, or you should reduce the number of cows in the pen. That's the idea. Yes, that's an important part of it, and therefore I also have my example on calculating economics is actually based on this, because that was also what we were thinking. Okay. Now for the study in the two private Danish herds, because now the idea was that we should take what was learned so far in the research on balanced, imbalanced cows, the cluster part of it, and put it into management in herd and see do the herd gain something from that. So, and what we use is FT-MIR analysis as Clément has presented for you. And again, this picture, the overall idea, remember that, is that the health and production problem, that's the idea that it can be effectively prevented by using milk measurement for the detection of cows in, now I use the term again, IMS, imbalanced metabolic status. Sorry for shifting a little bit on this. Introduction, yeah, you have probably heard it a number of times, but this is about physiological imbalance. A study years back showed that you can provide an index of IMS based on weekly measurement on blood metabolites. That could be a good indicator of imbalanced cows. And the problem was, as you can see here, it was based on blood metabolites. If you should make it relevant for the industry, then do it based on milk is much more smart. It's more easily accessible and cost effectively. And yeah, and that's what is shown in the study of Clément and colleagues. And the imbalanced cluster we are using is the one which is based on low glycose and low IGF and high NEFA and high BHB. And if you recall what Clément probably told you, then he have different kind of models, and the models from his paper that we used here was a separate primiparous model and a separate multiparous model, and the accuracy based on his study was 85 and 88, which is quite fair. So the hypothesis is that the imbalanced cows identified by this MIR analysis during early lactation is associated with subsequent impaired health and production, and secondly, that the treatment with propylene glycol improves health and production relatively more in cows identified by as being imbalanced. Point here is that it's not enough for farmer saying that we are able to detect imbalanced cows, because he would say, yeah, if you detect that, then you should also tell me what to do about it. And it should make sense all the way through. You should be able to detect it. I should have some something to do about it. And if I do that, then it should help me in some way. So therefore, we try to put it all into this perspective. We try to detect it, and we treat the cows. And if the success criteria is that we should be able to improve something for those cows that we detect as being imbalanced. So make that clear. We will find those imbalanced cows and do something with those, and they need to benefit from that. And this about using propylene glycol, you can do many things, but this is a quite direct thing to do something. So therefore, when we have identified some of those cows being imbalanced, we gave them propylene glycol by drench. Then we were quite sure that we have a treatment which is generally accepted as something that makes sense for dealing with this, and we are sure that the cows actually get the treatment. Just a few words about the two herds where we did our study, herd one and herd two, one with almost 800 cows, one with more than 1100 cows. The one with a culling rate, low culling rate, high culling rate, milk yield quite high in both herds. The culling to first intonation days, yeah, average, I would say, intonation rate, average conception rate, average dead cows per cow year, average the mastitis disorder, one with a low level, one with a more average or high level, digestibility and metabolic disorders per cow year, one high level, one at average level, and reproduction disorders per cow year. Yeah, more or less average. And when I say average, then I have a reference to Danish herd, because it depends on how you register and so on. But these are some of the key figures from the two herds, so you know a little bit what kind of herds we are dealing with. So our experimental design, we have these two herds, and in these two herds we completed 356 cows that calved during December 17 and March this year. During this period, we had milk samples collected before and after the treatment. And when we have collected the milk samples, we did this MIR testing of these, and we sent the results to Clément, and he did the analysis which he have explained for you, and sent back the results on the, if it's an imbalanced cow or not. We also analyzed the milk for metabolites, BHB, isocitrate, malate, and glutamate. And we also analyzed the milk for fat and protein. And the treatment, as I said, it was propylene glycol, and it was quite high level of propylene glycol, 500 milliliters for 5 days, and we did it by drench, so we were sure they get it. So another way to illustrate our design, we went out on a certain weekday and we picked up all cows that were only 1 week after calving. Actually, in the interval, we don't want the cows just the day after calving. So in the interval from 4 to 9 days in milk, we picked all the cows that were at that state. This week, we collected the milk from these cows, went back to our lab, make the analysis, sent the results to Clément. He analyzed the data from MIR, and he told us back which of those cows are imbalanced and which are not imbalanced. Based on that, we randomized on treatment. Some of them, of the imbalanced cow, get the treatment. Half of them get the treatment, half of them do not get the treatment. And again, also for the cows that are not imbalanced, the balanced cows, we randomized, so half of them get treatment, half of them not treatment. And that was done in the next week. So that would be 9 to 14 days in milk. And we came back to the herd again and took a milk sample again during the week, so that we had milk sample 2 at day 22 to 27 for each cow. And this random allocation was done individually for each parity and each herd. And in addition to this, in one of the herds, in herd 2, to test some repeatability of these samples, we took an additional sample here at sample 1, not only at 1 day, we did it also at day 2 and 3, so we were able to test some repeatability of this testing. Yes. Now, this one, as I know there's quite many numbers, but we have here our 356 cows allocated to the treatment. We have herd 1, herd 2, almost equal many cows, and we have parity groups, and we have healthy control, healthy treatment, imbalanced control, imbalanced treatment, and so on. What is interesting here is actually how many cows we have as being healthy and imbalanced. You can see these numbers are almost equal. Almost 50% in each herd was actually in the imbalanced group. So that's quite a difference compared to the study that where you have seen many results from these research herds. I think they had about a little bit more than 10% of the cows being imbalanced. In these two herds, when we did these analysis and using the method of Clément, we actually had that almost 50% of the cows were categorized in a group of being imbalanced. Okay, now just a few pictures from what was going on. It was winter time, and we have a researcher, young researcher from Brazil, so he thought it was important to take this picture of the snow in Denmark when he was collecting all the data. The one herd, the one herd here is a picture from the milking parlor, and of course it's a big milking parlor because he has 1,200 cows. So this room is working most of the time. There's space for 40, 44 cows in each row. And this is a basement beyond this, what you saw before. So here they are collecting the milk. And actually this bomatic system is quite nice for us because they have a system so they can easily make milk sampling every day. So of course we were taking additional milk samples compared to the ordinary milk recording system. But that was relatively easy for them to do. Here's the system, and they collected all the milk. No, they had this system taking a proportional sample of the milk during the milking process, and they collected all this milk for us in these bottles, and they kept it cool. And at the same day, we brought them home to our lab. We analyzed them in this MIR machine. We had the data. We sent them back. Yeah, some other samples were taken to our to another lab at our university for making the biomarker analysis. The data was sent to Clément and he was sending data back to us. So that's the procedure. Based on that, during this few days, we were able to classify if we had an imbalanced cow or not. Statistical models in general, the way we analyzed our data was that we used separate models for parity 1, 2 and 3. Miel just told you that primiparous cows do really behave differently compared to the other ones, so we had different models for each parity. Two-factor interaction were tested, we corrected for herd, and we had many variables, so we had a model selection procedure using the stepwise backward elimination based on AIC procedure. And we also forced some variables into the model. And more specifically, to answer the question, does treatment with propylene glycol drench for 5 days during this 9 to 14 days in milk improve the imbalanced status at the second sampling, 22 to 27 days in milk, and health and production in cows identified with to be in imbalanced status in the beginning? That was our goal, to see those cows that are imbalanced early, giving them treatment. Do that change something on their status being imbalanced or not in the second sample? That's one thing, if they're changed on being imbalanced or not. We would also like to see in general how they behave on health and production. So we had this model, the response, different responses modeled based on the variables of on the balance status early and treatment, not treatment, and some of other covariates where the response is partly what I said, the balanced, not balanced status late and the health and production parameters. And to identify if a cow was imbalanced or not, our standard, what we were going after, was this about the MIR cluster. But we also have this the alternative of looking at the biomarkers to classify if the cow were imbalanced or not. And then we had a number of separate models in different combination of response and the way we define cows as being in the balanced or imbalanced group. And the variables we used to define cows as being healthy to say something about the health and production of the cows. It was a fat protein, percentage of the milk, fat protein ratio, milk yield, test day milk yield, calving to first service interval, change in test day milk yield from early to end of propylene glycol treatment, change in milk from early to after our second sampling, and diseases in period 1, diseases in period 2. And diseases here, that's actually disease treatments, as we kept the record keeping of all the treatments that was done in the herds. Now to the results. What did the results show? First, disease treatments. You can see here all the disease treatments that we had in our data. The table is like the one before where we had the allocation of cows on groups. So you can see in the period one. That was until 20 day in milk, and the period two was after that. So again, we have the challenge that we do not have so many disease treatments actually in this group. Remember that this is data from 356 cows. So this is the number of treatment from these 356 cows. And the challenge is that we don't have so many treatments at all, and we don't certainly do not have many treatments in the late period. And another thing, Miel told you about machine learning and smart things. Sometimes we don't even need statistics. You can see here the difference between control and treatment. See here? I would say you don't need a lot of statistics telling you that the difference here are not significant. Okay, we do it, of course, by statistic modeling, but it's not surprisingly that we don't find a difference. Here is first this about the repeatability in the HERD 2. We, as I said, in HERD 2, we did 3 days in a row sampling of this metabolic status. And most of them, you can see here in priority 1, 2, and 3, first and second sample, day 1, day 2, change from day 1 to day 2, change from day 2 to day 3, change 9, consistent, 49, change consistent. So we can make other kind of statistics on this, but in general they are fairly consistent, I would say. Are you aware? You look a little bit. Are you aware what it is? It is that when I say consistent here, is that the same cow is classified as being imbalanced on day 1, 2, and 3, or is it shifting from balanced to imbalanced? If it's not shifting, then we say it's consistent, and otherwise it changes. And most of them do not change over these 3 days. Okay, now the results, looking at the metabolic status at sample 2, has that actually changed because of the treatment? If we look at it as the originally planned way, looking at the metabolic status defined by the MIR cluster, then there was actually no significant effect. So there were no significant effect of any of these, not effect of treatment, not effect on the original status when we looked at what is the status in the end. The same was the case when we looked at the metabolic status in the beginning compared to what was the metabolic status at sample 2. Based on these biomarkers, we actually did not find any significant effect. How about when we looked at the health and production? Here we look at what is the health and production parameters depending on the metabolic status in the beginning and the treatment with propylene glycol. And here the metabolic status is again the one based on the model of Clément, the FT-MIR cluster. And the results I have listed up here is for each of these response variables. When I put in a zero, say it says that there is no effect in priority 1, no effect in priority 2, no effect in priority 3. So the zeros are no significant effect. So what we see here is that very few effect of the initial status, very little effect of the treatment, and the combination of the two is also interaction. The interaction is also not significant in almost all of the models. looking at the health and production parameters when we, instead of the MIR, use the metabolic status based on the biomarkers, the four biomarkers. There were no one factor effect of the treatment. So what we have here is a result for the interaction with the propylene glycol, and that was what we were actually after. We would see if there was any additional effect of treatment in those cows that is in the imbalanced metabolic status. And again, the result is the same. Not to go into detail, but what we see here is mostly zeros. So we don't actually found an effect overall. So, conclusion from this study, based on experiment with 356 cows in two commercial dairy herds, we were not able to demonstrate a significant benefit from the applied detection of cows in physiological imbalance in early lactation and follow up by treatment with propylene glycol. That was somehow disappointing, but nevertheless, that was the result of our study. So, that was part two. So, question about this, question or comments on why could we have done something differently? Yeah. No, it was only for each cow, it was only one milk sample.
So on the beginning of period and on the
Each cow was sampled once in the beginning, once in the end. And the reason for this 4 to 9 is that we were coming one weekday, and when we took those cows that were at the proper distance from calving.
What was my idea? If you collect sample every day, you can see the difference with if exist changes on imbalance state or imbalance state to transition to balance state.
Yeah.
You can find also on the control also in treatment. That was the idea, and eliminate the more. But anyway, it doesn't also exist differences.
Yeah, but I agree, and that's also the perspective in the long run. That's why we use a technique like the MIR technique. In the long run, if it was really strong, then you maybe could have it in your herd, and you can do it every time you milk a cow.
Yeah, that means the noises.
Yeah. So that is certainly a limitation of our study. Yeah. But looking at this, because actually in herd number two, we did this additional sampling on sample one, we did that one day, but we came back day two and day three, just 3 days in a row, looking at what were there any differences. And there are differences. You can see that some of them do change the metabolic status, but most of them stay in the same. Yeah. Questions, comments?
Can I comment on the...
Sure.
Cluster methodology that we tried, so that was almost 2 years ago. So the reason, what we now think is that the model that we used here included the heifers. And we think that that's probably because the model was fitting the heifers as well at the same time, which makes us think that that's probably why we don't see them when we cross-validate that like this again. So one day, I hope that we can go back and then reclassify them and see what the results are.
But in this study, when we analyzed a result, we analyzed the parity 1, 2, and 3 separately. But also in the classifying of cows as being. Here is the procedure we used to classify cows. We used this procedure of Clément. And we used a separate model for primiparous cows and another separate model for multipowers cows. Yeah. So you can see, I think that we have a challenge with the primipowers, as you mentioned. And based on discussions in a project group, we used the model saying primipowers model was an all cow model, but applied specifically for primipowers. So I think that's not so strong, the primipowers part. But at all, the way we have done it, we did not allow the primipowers cow to make any damage to our result for multipowers cows in this way, because all the primipowers data and models were not influencing what we were seeing on the multipowers part. But what we will do, we will try an alternative model of Clément. He have maybe also your model, but Clément, he has an alternative model of doing this, an SVM model, I think. Maybe he told you about that. So we still have additional things we can try, but yeah. Okay.